Very good afternoon, guys, and welcome to this Sunday special where we are going to have a mixed bag of questions for microbiology. So up till now, we've studied two aspects. If you see the past 6 days, we've done a high yielding point revision course on the YouTube channel, and that was including general microbiology, and the second part of it was fungal organisms or mycology. So I thought that why not combine the two and give you some questions, practice questions, and at the same time, add on something to your knowledge if I can. So let's start this Sunday special of microbiology high yielding points. Also, I hope all of you have been able to download the PDF from the Telegram channel. So every time I upload a video, the same day following that, I upload the PDF on the Telegram channel so that there can be a rapid revision that you guys can do. So let's begin, and it's a very quick, I'm not teaching much because I've been teaching you throughout the last 6 days, but I'm going to ask you more of questions, and yes, let's start right away. So let's start reading. There's a 72-year-old man who's come with exacerbation of chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, COPD, was admitted to the ICU and intubated. Because of the occurrence of central venous catheter-related MRCA, so there's a CVC-related methicillin-resistant staph aureus bacteremia, he was treated with certain drugs. They've given even the minimum inhibitory concentration of the drugs. Now, 1 week after his discharge to home, he was again admitted to the emergency department for a dissecting aneurysm of the abdominal aorta, which was promptly treated by surgery. The physician suspected a chronic bacterial infection and sent him for cultural examination. The microbiologist is growing his culture on nutrient agar, and what is the concept of a conception of agar in the nutrient agar. So basically, cutting the long story short, we started off with a really lengthy history, and this is the typical type of question that you are expected in your upcoming NEET PG, where there'll be a long stem question instead of asking you a simple one-liner that what is the composition of agar in a nutrient agar. So that's as simple as that. Or I know all of you know the answer. The answer to the question is 2%, but I hope you've understood how they are twisting and turning the question, giving you a medicine question, going on from MRCA to dissecting aneurysm, and then asking you just the composition of agar. So if you want to make it into a semi-solid, you use a 2% agar. However, if you want to make it firm, and I've taught you this in the very first class, if you want to make it firm, you use a 5 to 6% of agar. And when do you want to make it firm? When you want to inhibit a particular type of a motility of a bacteria. So when you want to inhibit the Proteus swarming, you don't want the Proteus to be mobile, motile, and do the swarming, exhibit swarming. You make the medium very, very firm. How do you make it firm? By adding a lot of agar into it. So all scenarios, it is 2%. For firmness, it is 6%. Let's move on to the next question. Now we have next, a microbiologist intern wants to sterilize nutrient media. What is the method of sterilization that involves exposure to 100 degrees? So at 100 degrees for 20 minutes on 3 days. So he's done 20 minutes, 20 minutes, 20 minutes. At 100 degree, I hope you remember a simple mnemonic, T20. So what is that thing known as? It is known as tindalization. But I want to ask you something. If I give you this same question, so here it's easy. They've done at 100 degree, 20, 20, 20 for 3 days, and T20 is tindalization. However, if I ask you the same thing, same options, and I ask you which of the following methods is used for the sterilization of media usually, then to sterilize most common is autoclave. That is, at what temperature? Autoclave is done at 121 degrees Celsius for 15 minutes, and what's the pressure that we keep? 15 pound square inch. Okay, coming to the next question. This was one of the most controversial questions when I had uploaded the bacterial genetics chapter. Under the comments, I saw that all of you were struggling to get the answer right, so I put it up for you again. A microbiology student was studying about DNA transformation and its property. What is the mechanism of direct transfer of free DNA? Now remember, direct transfer of free DNA. They've asked you free DNA and direct transfer. The best answer over here will be transformation. And what was transformation, guys? Transformation was more of that if this is a bacteria, for example, this is a bacteria, and this is some kind of a free DNA. this is some kind of a free DNA, then there's going to be uptake of free DNA. So there's going to be a direct transfer. Where did this free DNA come from? Free DNA has probably come from some donor bacteria. So there's going to be a donor bacteria lysis. The donor bacteria breaks, the DNA of the donor bacteria comes out, the DNA of the donor bacteria is then taken up by the recipient bacteria. So can I say it is the direct transfer of free DNA? If they would have said there's a direct contact between the two bacterias, if they would have said that, okay, this is one bacteria, this is another bacteria, and there's a direct transfer by contact, contact answer would have been conjugation. Contact answer would have been conjugation. You know the conjugation tube that is formed in both of them. And if they would have said there is transfer by means of a bacteriophage, then your answer would have been transduction. Moving on to the next question. A person presented to the OPD with cough and fever. His sputum sample was sent for the culture to identify the causative organism. The sample was cultured on a blood agar. What type of a media is blood agar? So remember, in the exam, guys, microbiology, the trick of saving time, because approximately 20 questions expected. So how do you save out on time? What are you going to do? You are going to quickly read the options. So like when I read the options here, I knew it's a microbio question. When I read the options here, I knew it's a bacterial genetics question. It just took me 1 second to analyze. Okay, media question has come, it's from microbio. So when you start reading, the last line pretty much helps you a lot. Have they asked me about the media? Have they asked me about the treatment? Have they asked me about the type of, the organism, gram positivity, staining? So the last line will actually, retrospective approach, the last line will tell you a lot. So what kind of a media is a blood agar? Blood agar is an enriched media. Why enriched media? Because it provides additional things for the growth. So now I want you to know that when I'm talking about selective media, when I'm talking about differential media and enrichment broth, what do I mean by that? I think differential media is the easiest. Differential media is the easiest because it helps in differentiation. For example, is it a lactose fermenter or is it a non-lactose fermenter? Is the media going to help me know the organism is a sucrose fermenter or non-sucrose fermenter? For that matter, doesn't blood agar that you're talking about over here, blood agar also differentiate between something being hemolytic or non-hemolytic, right? So the whether the organism can cause hemolysis or not cause hemolysis, so kind of differential also. At the same time, it is enriched. Why is it enriched? Because it is going to provide nutrients. You've put something added onto it. You've put blood into it. It's not a plain agar. You've put blood into it. So at the same time, it's also providing the organism nutrition. So it's an enriched media, also helping in differentiation. Now, what do you mean by the other ones? What do you mean by selective media? Selective media means I want to selectively grow one organism. Right? So there's going to be encouraging the desired microbes. Right? So you're going to selectively allow the, you want bacteria X to grow. Okay? So you selectively let bacteria X grow and then you don't want bacteria A to grow. So you go and suppress it. That is what you mean by selective. Selectively grow one and suppress the other. So the concept is, how do you let only one grow? If there's only one student in the exam, only he is going to top, right? So that is what they do over here. One bacteria, they let that grow very well. All the other bacterias, they're going to suppress. So selective media works on suppression of the unwanted microbes. Next, what is enrichment broth? Now we call it an enrichment broth. We call it an enrichment broth because it tends to come as a liquid media. Broth means liquid. Now, enrichment is similar to selective. In this also, you want only one bacteria to grow. You don't want the others to grow. But in this, instead of suppressing, the student whom you want should top, you give him extra classes and you give him some points by which you, you know, tell him exam expected potential questions. You increase the levels of the microbe that you want to grow to detectable levels by giving it some enrichment, by giving it some suitable environment, by suitable nutrients. So it's similar to selective, but in this you're not suppressing the unwanted microbes. The organism that you want to grow, you are just giving it some extra nutrients so that it can be grown to detectable levels. I hope that is clear with everyone, because now I want you to answer. A liquid media. So when I say liquid media, have you already started thinking of something known as an enrichment broth? Still, let's read. It is used to suppress the commensal bacteria while allowing the pathogen to remain viable and grow. Which of the following is an enrichment media? They've directly asked you. Like I said, when you know it's a microbiome question, you directly see the last line. Alkaline peptone water. Yes, this is the enrichment media for Vibrio. Enrichment broth for Vibrio. The Monsoor's TTPW, that is the taurocollate telluride peptone water, this is also useful for Vibrio. Selenite F broth. So these are water broth. Selenite F broth, all of you know, for Salmonella, Shigella. So basically, yes, all of them are enrichment broths. Your answer to the question is all of the above. Coming to the next question, you have to identify the wrong pair. So selenite F broth, enriched media, clad, differential, Pikes, transport, TCBS, selective. So first and foremost, TCBS, yes, selective, because TCBS, thiosulfate, I've taught you this. It's a two ways it's useful. Number one, we've got thiosulfate, citrate, bile salt, and the main thing, sucrose. So what is TCBS, guys? TCBS stands for thiosulfate, citrate, bile salt, sucrose. So please remember, bile salt is what it is going to make it selective. It will selectively allow which type of organisms to grow. It selectively allows Vibrio to grow. But at the same time, sucrose makes it differential media. Sucrose also makes it a differential media because it helps you in differentiating whether it is sucrose fermenter versus non-sucrose fermenter. So it is a selective plus a differential media. Coming to the next. Pikes media, yes, that's a transport media. And do you remember it's for what? It is for Streptococcus pyogenes. So remember, pyogenes, pike media. Coming to the next, clad media, definitely differential clad, lactose. So helps you in differentiating between lactose fermenter versus non-lactose fermenter. Coming to the first one, selenite F broth. If you've used a broth, will you call it an enriched media or will you call it an enrichment broth? So if you've used the word broth or water, liquid media, you should be calling it an enrichment broth. So what is your final answer? Answer number one. Coming to the next, which of the following is not a method? Not a method of cell wall demonstration. All of you are very close to your exam. These kind of words are a game changer. Not a method. All are true except. Which of the following is not true? So these not, except, please read carefully. So which of the following is not a method of identifying the cell wall? Let's read one by one. I hope you all know. Methods of identification of cell wall has a mnemonic known as registered medical practitioner, which is a doctor. So let me just quickly teach you what is registered medical practitioner, that is a doctor. So first and foremost, R for reaction with antibody. Do you agree that the cells are going to have an antigen? If they have an antigen, then you can react them with an antibody. M for mechanical rupture of the cell. And micro dissection. So mechanical rupture can mean macro dissection, and then there is a micro dissection. P for using plasmolysis, and D for differential staining. So coming back, I'm going to revise it for all of you. What do you mean by RMP doctor? R stands for, so registered medical practitioner, that is doctor. R stands for reaction with antibodies. That is not given in my question. M stands for micro dissection. And micro dissection, I can see in my question. M also stands for mechanical rupture. That is not there in my question. P stands for plasmolysis. P stands for plasmolysis, which is there in the question. D stands for differential staining, which is there. And I hope you know which differential staining? Gram stain. Isn't the best method to differentiate the cell wall, method of cell wall, whether it is a gram positive cell wall or a gram negative cell wall, by a differential stain? So definitely these three are methods, which is not a method for cell wall demonstration. It is a Quellung reaction. I hope you know Quellung reaction is something that you have for the capsule. Now, that is your homework of the day. Quellung reaction, you have to tell me two questions. What is the chemical that we are going to use in the Quellung reaction? And what is the organism? Or if not one, then what are the type of organisms? I think you know the answer. What are the type and the common organisms for which the Quellung reaction is studied? And in this method, what is the chemical that we put? So everyone, you know, you might be getting a notification. I do like your answers when they are right. And most of you are always right because you're an intelligent lot anyway. But yes, I do follow them. And it's very interesting to see all of you right away promptly answer after the video is uploaded. So I'm looking forward to this as well. Okay, so which is not a method? Quellung reaction is for a capsule. I've given you a hint. There's going to be some kind of a swelling. So let's see how many of you get that. Coming to the next question. Okay, let's read. Griffith had suggested that a bacteria are capable of transferring genetic information through a process called transformation. So he conducted an experiment using mice and various bacteria. So which bacteria was used in the Griffith's experiment? Basically, transformation which was discovered by Griffith in 1921. That transformation is using which bacteria? So this is a multiple choice. This came in the PGI exam. Obviously, that's now a part of INICET, but yes, which is the organism? So he used Streptococcus pneumoniae. He used both. He studied this on both capsulated and non-capsulated Streptococcus pneumoniae. So yes, the answer is both of these. Remember, Griffith, transformation, Streptococcus pneumoniae. And I just taught you what's transformation. It's the uptake of free DNA. Remember, it's the free DNA uptake that we have that you need to know. Okay, having said that, let's move on to the next question, and that is this. Very important. What are the bacterial indicator? So they've given you the bacterial indicators for various sterilization techniques. For a quality check, you have to identify the wrong pair. So Clostridium tetani, hot air oven, Bacillus sterothermophilus, plasma sterilization, Bacillus pumilus, ionizing radiation, Bacillus sterothermophilus, ethylene oxide. No, if you remember, ethylene oxide was a gas sterilization, and G for gas sterilization, it is Bacillus globigi. It is Bacillus globigi. So why not make a quick list, guys? Quickly tell me the controls. This is something that you need to quickly revise with me. Hot air oven. So for hot air oven, the first one that was written, Clostridium tetani. Other than Clostridium tetani, any Bacillus that we can use, and that is going to be Bacillus subtilis. And do you know what is the new name that they started using for Bacillus subtilis, which is basically a cousin brother only, is going to be Bacillus atrophius. So do not get worried when you see this name. It's the same, almost the same. When I say autoclave and plasma sterilization, remember, for autoclave and plasma sterilization, we have Bacillus. Some people call it sterothermophilus. Some people call it geothermophilus. So yes, these are the two for auto. These are the ones for autoclave and plasma sterilization. For filtration, filtration means minute pores, right? Filtration is a minute pore. So if filtration is a minute pore, you guys are going to tell me that what is the Bacillus? It is actually Brevendimonas diminuta. Brevendimonas diminuta. So the word diminuta. The word diminuta will tell you that I'm talking about minute pores. Okay, talking about radiation. For radiation, it is Bacillus pumilus. And how did we learn it? The P, you're going to make it into an R. You're going to make the P into an R. So yes, there should not be a problem. P made into an R. Lastly, what I asked you over here, gas sterilization. So I hope you remember G for G. For gas sterilization, it is Bacillus globigi. It is Bacillus globigi. So here coming back, this was a wrong statement out here. Okay, guys, coming to the next question, and here you go. So in this one, very important. In a bacterial growth curve, the period in which maximum cell size is obtained. Maximum cell size, one of the most famous questions. So maximum cell size is obtained at the end of the lag phase. I call this the lockdown phase. So what are we going to do? We are going to read the bacterial growth curve quickly. But before that, we are going to answer one more question. Which of the following phase shows high susceptibility to antibiotics? High susceptibility to antibiotics. So they've labeled A, B, C and D. So which is the phase which shows high susceptibility where antibiotics, bactericidal antibiotics are going to show an effect? It is this one. It is this one, that is stage number B. So I'm going to tell you what this graph is, but first I want you to study what is a bacterial growth curve. So when I have a bacterial growth curve, it has four phases. Number one, there's something known as a lag phase. There's something known as a lag phase where everything is lagging. It's like a lockdown phase. You're just sitting at one place, eating and becoming fat. That is what a lag phase is. Then there comes a log phase when the lockdown has opened and you've started activity. So then there's a log phase. Once the bacteria started activity, there comes a time where they become stationary. And stationary phase ke baad, finally when death happens more, that is decline phase. So first know the four phases. And this was one of the questions I gave you on day one as homework. There's a lag phase, then a log phase, then a stationary phase and a decline phase. So let's go one by one. When I talk about the lag phase is all about, like I said, it's like a lockdown. It's like a lockdown where you're just sitting, you're eating, you are conserving your resources, and as a result, you're becoming fat. So that is what's happened to all of us, right? So there's increase in the enzymes, there's increase in all the metabolites, the bacteria is accumulating a lot of things, accumulating all its energy. As a result, the size is becoming more. So can I say at the end of this phase, at the end of the phase, there's going to be maximum size that you see in a bacteria? Lag phase. Now coming to the next, that is the log phase. Log phase is when the lockdown is opened and we started moving around. So it's division, it's exponential phase. So can I say maximum activity will be seen here because maximum reproduction, maximum division is happening here. And as a result, all the bacteria stain uniformly. All of them are dividing, all of them are forming new bacteria, uniform staining. And let me tell you, this is the phase. This is the phase where there is going to be maximum action of and high susceptibility to antibiotics. So if you give a bactericidal drug like penicillin, there's going to be death. The bacteria are going to die. If you give a bactericidal drug, if you give a bacteriostatic drug, the growth will stop. So if you give a cidal drug, the bacteria will die. If you give a static drug, the growth will stop. And theoretically, the growth will keep on going if you do not give any drug. So theoretically they say the growth curve should be a lag phase, then a log phase, and then the bacteria should keep on multiplying. That is what they say theoretically, but that doesn't happen practically. Even in the absence of antibiotics, please remember, you know that the growth curve is going to ultimately come to a stationary phase. There will be a lag, there will be a log, and then it will come to a stationary phase. Why? Because now the cells have started to die. So there's an equilibrium maintained. In stationary phase, there's an equilibrium maintained that the live cells and the dead cells are going to be equal. So now you start getting non-uniform staining. You've got live cells and dead cells. Please remember, in the stationary phase, there is going to be sporulation, which is a very, very famous question, and there's going to be toxin production. So there's going to be toxin production and spore production. So ST for both of these previous year question. Finally, towards the end, there's going to be cell death when the number will go down and involution forms are present. So asking and dealing with it again, coming to the first one, the first question was, in the bacterial growth curve, maximum cell size, you know, if you have this as the growth curve, the maximum cell size is here, that is at the end of lag phase. If I say which out of these phases were you going to see best action to antibiotics, so you will say for antibiotics my answer is B. If I say which of these shows you the spore production, so for sporulation you are going to say spore and toxin. For spore and toxin, stationary phase. Well guys, done with this. How about taking up another question? Easy one. Identify the wrong pair of sterilization technique and its temperature setting. So let's see. Autoclaving, 15 minutes, 125 degrees, 15 lbs pressure. As of now, sounds right. Tyndallization, T20. So 100 degree, 20 minutes, 3 days, 20, 20, 20, T20, sounding right. Coming to pasteurization. Now, I remember pasteurization had two methods. One was the Holder's method and one was the flash method. So, in Holder's method, we had to hold on for longer. We had to hold on 6330. So, there's 63 degrees for 30 minutes. In flash method, it was 7220. 72 degrees for 20 seconds. Higher temperature but flash within seconds. So pasteurization 6330, 63 degree, 30 minutes. This sounds like the Holder's method. This is right. What is the fourth one? Inspissation. This is not right. Inspissation 160 degree for 2 hours. No, inspissation is a technique which is a less than 100 degree technique. So remember, inspissation was also a 3-day technique of roughly 20 to 30 minutes. So 20 to 30 here, 20 to 30 here, 20 to 30 here, and the temperature had to be between 80 to 85 degrees. So we always learnt it as 80-20, 80-20. So remember, 80 degrees Celsius, 20 minutes, and this had to go on for 3 days, 80-20, 80-20. Well, having said that, how about taking one last question of the day? And here you go. The sequence of steps of ZN staining. So first, in such questions, just think of your mnemonic first. What was the mnemonic of ZN staining? It was class has asked mnemonic. Class has asked mnemonic. So what are you going to do? You are first going to analyze in your mind that, okay, class, carbyl fusion. So this has to come first. It's supposed to start with 4. So you write 4 here. Class has heating. So next is heating. So 4, 1. A for some acid alcohol, sulfuric acid. So sulfuric acid, 3. And M for either methylene blue or maleachite green. So 2. 4, 1, 3, 2. And that's your answer. 4, 1, 3, 2. So instead of going directly into such options, best is make a sequence of your own and then pick it up from here as to what suits you guys the best. Okay. And that we finish off today's session. It was a rapid mixed bag. I hope you guys have enjoyed. And yes, I included more of general microbiology rather than mycology, because mycology I just taught you 2 days back to back. So I thought a rapid mixed bag of general microbiology out here. And with that, we are done. I hope you guys are also aware of the plus subscription, which is giving you access to long stem questions, 25K questions. And that's a new feature that has come up. So we would really want all of you to take advantage of the same. Also, starting 1st September, we have batches for every target, be it FMG, NEET PG, even the last 1 week of NEET PG. So previous year questions are being discussed. The next year exam 2022, and apart from that, every Saturday grand test. So exam going students, you still have till now it was Saturdays. Now you can see these are more frequent because we are approaching the exam. So almost on an alternate day basis, you will be able to get your grand test 30th, 1st, 3rd, 5th, 7th, 9th. So this is just rapid grand test before your exam. So I hope you're taking benefit of the same. And if you want to join the Plus subscription, be it Plus or Iconic, these are the two subscription plans available, and that's the code. Well, guys, thanks a lot for joining in. What's the plan of action now? So, plan of action is that now we are going to meet again at 10 p.m. But the twist in the story is that instead of image of the day, you will today have mnemonic of the day. I know all of you are very scared of that Runyon's classification of atypical mycobacteria. I'll be simplifying that. And then tomorrow, the timeline remains the same, 3 p.m., 10 p.m. on YouTube. So, that is not going anywhere. So, I'm hoping all of you are following the same. Thanks a ton for joining in. Have a great Sunday. Study well. And see you again at 10 o'clock, this time with Mnemonic of the Day.